You got it tuned to Wopop on KEXP. I'm Darek Mazzone, your DJ and host. Thanks for being here. Thanks for watching and thanks for listening. Hi, how's it going? So I'm Darek Mazzone. I do a show called Wopop on KEXP. And I've been at the station since 1992 or 93, I can't remember then. But Tom was one of the first people I met. I heard the station as I was driving across the country. And I'm sorry, when I got into Seattle after driving across the country, and it was completely blown away. And I'm incredibly grateful to be part of it right now. So I'm getting out of my script. So let me just give you a quick rundown. There's a purpose to what we do at KEXP. It's a different kind of radio station than exists anywhere that I know of right now. There used to be similar stations like it at college radio stations, but what we're able to harness at KEXP, our curiosity, our interest in music, and specifically me, interest into the music of the entire planet, would not be able to exist on a commercial radio station or even a media outlet as exists right now. It's just the bottom line is too hard and the pressure to, that's too eclectic, that's too interesting, that's too exotic for a general audience to take. The pressure for that would be way too strong. So for me to be able to play this music and to let these artists be heard, which is the most vital point of what I'm trying to do here, is unparalleled in the fact that we can do this at KEXP, and the fact that we're reaching people at the level we are right now is mind-boggling. Because fundamentally, you have to understand, we're all nerds and geeks. We just like, you know, we love to turn each other on with strange music, and the fact that we have an audience of millions is mind-boggling to me. You know, I'm a gray hair. I've been doing this for a long time. I started DJing in 1987. The fact that we can reach this audience is utterly mind-boggling to me. If you were to tell me, you know, 20 years ago, A, that ganja is legal, that gays can marry, and that KEXP is as big as it is right now, it would have been like, you are tripping, this is insane. But it's really happening. Okay, so let's watch. Yeah, one love, one heart. Let's get together and awesome. That was a little video that I produced just to get people to, because our biggest audience is online and they're watching us. So I wanted to make a little video like, check this out. You know, this is more than just a radio station, because we are going through this interesting transition. We're always going to be radio. And I think, you could correct me wrong, we're the biggest brick and mortar radio station on YouTube, which is an interesting dichotomy. When you think of YouTube, you don't think of radio, but it is the most powerful media, most powerful song discovery platform in the world right now, and we have a huge presence on there, and I think we're the biggest radio station in the world. I could be wrong, but I think I'm pretty close there. Everybody knows what world music is? Any audience? Okay, so a little bit history of world music. For a long time, artists from different parts of the world were just not being heard. Around the mid-70s, early 80s, it got easier to record music, so all of these artists, such as Vela Niklapakuti or Sibisa, started being played, and you needed a place to put the records at the record store, because back then, that's how people were buying stuff. So all of these, and Tom Smith can speak to that, working at a record store, you would get all these records, and you're sitting there, like, where do I put this? It's not rock, it's not R&B, it's not jazz, what do I need to do with it? So somebody came up, I think Charlie Gillett is a contemporary of mine at BBC, let's call it world music. Everybody hated it. As soon as you come up with a name, everybody hates it. It's like, what are you talking about, world music? But it worked for a while, because it allowed people to find it. And in this section, you'd find Ravi Shankar to, you know, Naima, to, you know, the Descendants or something like that. It just wouldn't make sense because this is Indian classical music and this is like dirty hip hop from Belgium. It doesn't really work. When I started Wopop, I felt it was time to actually speak to it in a different way because two things happened. One, with laptops, with computers, you could actually record music any location. And then once the internet happened, you could disseminate that music pretty quickly. So I came up with a term called modern global music because I felt that world music didn't make sense anymore. And you needed something that spoke to the modern aspect of the music, that it was coming at you so quickly. And I'm at a point right now where literally I played an MP3 Tuesday that was produced last week and I just got it, in my email. And I put it on and then suddenly it's presented all over the world. That's unheard of. So that doesn't make it world music anymore. It makes it something else. And nobody was coming up with the term. I was like, okay, let's just call it modern global. And then we could call it Moglo because he got to shrink it down and make it work. So another thing, I'm an immigrant and I grew. So being an immigrant is an interesting place, especially now in this country. For a long time, it was fine. But now it's a little bit of a crazy pressure around that. But from an immigrant, you hear things differently. You have a different kind of relationship with your new home, and you have a different kind of relationship with your old home. There's a term in Portuguese called saudade, which is this longing for the past, even though the past could never, you can never go home again. Not to quote Chrissy Hynde, but you can't really go home again. And a lot of the songs that you're going to be hearing from these artists are about that. Like, you can't go back to the village, you can't go back to your home, you can't go back to your country, but you still long for it. It's this interesting sense of nostalgia, which really drives a lot of the musical expressions that are coming from that. And so for me personally, when I first started, I was getting all this music from different parts of the world, and I found this interesting line that was going through that. And that line is the thing, is not the thing that made each sound different, is this thing that made each sound the same. And I found that, like, that's the thing that really makes us all unique, but yet we're all the same people. They're all the same expression, all the same vibration. And then I was like, I got to put this stuff out. There wasn't a show like that. I was like, let's, I'm getting all this music. Let's hear it. Let's get it out. So a prime example of that is a band called Ladysmith Black Mambazo, who we finally had on the air, and I've been a huge fan of theirs, even pre-Paul Simon. Now, mind you, there's an interesting story to this. Like, KXP's moved into its new home. Has anybody seen the new home here? It's huge. It's amazing. We couldn't have a band like Ladysmith Black Mambazo before because we were in a tiny room about, you know, yay big. We tried having bands like Antibalas. We had Polyphonic Spree. We had to mic them in the bathroom. We had to mic them in the hallway. You know, we got them in there. You got to get them in. Now we could actually put a band in, you know, and there's room to move. There's room to dance. And it's truly, truly amazing. Check it out.
Homeless, moonlight sleeping on the midnight lake,
and we are
homeless,
we are
homeless, moonlight sleeping on the midnight lake,
and we are
homeless,
we are
homeless, moonlight sleeping on the midnight lake,
and we are
homeless,
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 homeless.
Moonlight sleeping on the midnight.
Kisiyo ya,
Strong wind, strong wind, destroy our homes. Many dead tonight it could be.
Strong wind,
strong wind, strong wind. Many dead tonight it could be.
And we are
homeless,
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 homeless.
Moonlight sleeping.
We are homeless,
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 homeless.
Moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake. We homeless, we homeless, we moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake.
So that would not have been possible in our old studio. And the first time I heard that, it was just, there were tears in people's eyes. It was like amazing to have that sound at KXP. And it's only possible to the millions that were generated by our donors. You know, it's just, we're getting little donations from our listeners because our listeners trust us. And that's the thing that really separates us from like Spotify or a streaming service or any other radio station. It's that level of trust. And that was actually amplified last Thursday when Prince died. People just all over the world started listening to KXP because they trust us. They know that we would do honor to the artist. And they trust me. They know that I will be playing an artist that I feel is important. And they know that I haven't let them down. Our servers blew out, of course, because everybody just, you know, it's like, Prince, I got to listen to KXP. But that's just part of the magic that we can actually make happen. And it's amazing. It's literally amazing. Okay, so a little background on me. As I said, I'm an immigrant. I grew up in Poland. English is not my native language. My Polish is horrible right now, but, you know, that's just the way it happens. I love music from a really early age. I grew up in a Warsaw Pact country. And the thing that was interesting at that time, it was hard to leave the country, but there were these cultural exchanges that were going on with other communist countries. So I would get music from Laos, from Angola, from Mozambique, from Vietnam, and you would kind of get that. There was this, like, you know, socialist exchange that was going on. And it was also presented as a bulwark against the West. And, you know, yes, it was not a good time. And anytime I have, like, Soviet expat bands come in, we always joke about, you know, this, like, oh yeah, remember socialism? Yeah, it kind of sucked, actually. But the music was decent. There was some interesting stuff that was going on. And you could hear things that you can't hear right now. I travel a lot, and I tell you, I love her to death, but Beyoncé is everywhere. And all these artists from all over the world want to be Beyoncé, which is great, but it's also, you lose a little something. I'm not an ethnomusicologist. I don't take music, you'll hear with this amazing band coming up, I don't like it to be like static, like, you know, this thing exists and it needs to be preserved. There's a part of me that's like, yeah, it does, but music is the one art form that plays well with everybody, plays well with everything. A lot of the music that we love right now, I'll give you an example, Congolese rumba happened when Cuban merchant marines landed in Accra or landed in Kinshasa, and they were playing Cuban music from gramophones, you know, from their wherever they were staying, and musicians would just be like sitting underneath the hotel trying to figure out how to get these riffs. And this is how it all evolves. And it's happening now with hip hop, it's happening now with electronic music. It's not something that needs to stay static. It's something that needs to grow, and it's something that needs to evolve. And KXP, and especially a show like mine, Wopop, shows the beginning. Like, I've played field recordings from like 1890, first time a white man was ever in Bali recording something, to, as I said, something that just dropped from Bamako last week, you know, some crazy new hip-hop group playing Ngoni with some vocals, you know, talking about the fact that the north of their country is super oppressive right now and you can't play music. Artists are getting killed, music instruments are getting destroyed, recording studios are getting burnt down. So this is a powerful thing. It's fun, it's hilarious, but it's also super, super powerful and it needs to be preserved. Then we have Boston. I started working at a college radio station, WMFO. Boston had a great music scene on its own. It's a college town, so there was so much going on. But at the same time, I was like, okay, you know, Mission of Burma, really cool. I wanted to hear some other stuff. There's a huge expat population in Boston, and some of the clubs were taking risks, but it was really hard to, like, you know, for Christ's sake, we've got, you know, the best guitarist in Congo here right now, back then in Zaire. He needs a place to play. So it was, you know, we were trying, as always, we were trying to do stuff. We had limited success. With KXP, we're successful. You know, we're actually able to do this, which is amazing. I'm getting goosebumps right now. And then KCMU. Unlike, I don't know if you guys have done this, I fell in love super early, got engaged, horrible heartbreak. I needed to drive across the country to escape it. And that's what brought me here. KCMU was amazing. Riz was on the air, and it was like, who is this guy? How is this possible? I came in, I walked to the station, I met Tom, I met Don, I met Riz a little bit later, and I was like, I want to be part of this thing. I was working at an ad agency then, and I was like, and I did the overnight shift. It was tough. I was, you know, early 20s, I could do it, but I was on from midnight to 6 a.m. on a Monday night, and I had to get to work the next day. Whoa, it was tough. But it was awesome, because we could do what we want. And then I was asked to do an international show, and I did it. And it's been going on ever since. I work as a tech and marketing consultant, and I've always been interested in how technology works with artists, or how artists work with technology, because a lot of this music that I play 20 years ago would not, 30 years ago would not have been possible, because there would have been like a Peter Gabriel or a Paul Simon said, I like this, so I'm going to sweep you into my recording studio, and then we're going to disseminate you, anointed by Paul Simon or Peter Gabriel, which was fine. But now, you don't need that anymore. You have a laptop, you have a mic, you have the internet, you're a great artist, you could be a great artist, you could be a really bad artist. That's the thing that you have to understand about KCMU. We're the ears that protect you from really shitty music. Because, you know, I decided to drive across the country. Most of the artists that I hear right now, I got my heart broken, so I'm going to write you a song, and I'm going to have force you to listen to it. We're stuck listening to that. We have a secret weapon at KXP called Don Yates. The man is, he deserves a Netflix show. He listens to everything, and so much of it is so horrible. But he gets it out, and we do too, but we give you the best of the best, so you don't have to torture yourself. So, what pop is about bringing people together. You know, we, for the first time, a lot of these artists don't get heard in their home country. You know, they get heard on my show, and then suddenly they become something bigger in their home country, because there isn't a space for that kind of stuff to happen. One of the great things also about KXP, like as I said with Prince, when Prince died, Cheryl, you know, John was finishing his show, Cheryl was on, and suddenly it was like, we're going to do Prince. We can do that. You know, we are DJ driven. It's just like something's happening in the world. I had a show in 94. There was a huge snowstorm. I just dedicated my show to the snow, played music from Scandinavia. People were like, this is amazing. I had no idea. Because there's something about music. It's the most unique art form. It's different than film. It's different than painting. There's just something about it which you share, and it's communal, even you're doing it even by yourself. There's a huge expat community. They love hearing me. It's like, you know, in a cab, I'm getting calls from Ethiopian, Somali cab drivers, Eritrean cab drivers. Like, it's a different kind of feeling when they're hearing music from their home, like Mahmoud Ahmed. They feel like they're part of something. You know, they're not this little ghetto and aside. KXP is a big station, and to hear music from those countries, from their home countries, changes their relationship with their new home. And the other part is that I've been doing a show since 93. A lot of people have been listening. A lot of people get inspired to go check these artists out. The thing that you find out is, like, musicians tend to be really open. People go like, I had this one story, somebody was like, I played a lot of music from Morocco, Jujuka was coming in, somebody got their passport for the first time, went to the Atlas Mountains, went to the village of Jujuka, was treated like a queen, and changed her life. And I hear these stories all the time. I went to Budapest, I went to Marrakesh, I went to Kingston because I heard the music on your show for the first time, and I have a different relationship. You know, that's the fundamental thing, is like, we're all kind of the same. I have many goals with my show, but one of them is, like, leave as soon as you can, go explore, go to other countries, because that's the thing that's going to make everything better. You know, if you just stay in a silo and you become afraid of the other, we're all screwed. But if you go, there's hope. This is part of our secret sauce. We don't underestimate our audience ever. We will take risks. All the specialty shows are amazing. I play music from the entire freaking world, you know, 1895 to last week. That's a broad range. I don't dumb it down ever, and I take risks with it. We had Stromae on. A lot of people didn't know who Stromae was. I travel. It's like Stromae is huge. He's like Beyonce and Prince and Michael Jackson all in one. Rwandan refugee living in Belgium, and now he's singing a song for the Red Devils, the Belgian World Cup team. It's like, this is an amazing story. And I was like, please, can we get you on? We got him on. He came in super sweet. Suddenly, a million views on YouTube. Not going into number porn, but that's huge for an artist like that. Here's Stromae.
Evora, 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 evora. Les effluves te rompent dans ta voix, me font tourner la tête. Tu me fais danser du bout des doigts, comme tes cigarettes, immobile comme à ton habitude. Mais es-tu devenu muette, oh, est-ce à cause des kilomètres que tu ne me réponds plus? Evora, Evora, tu ne m'aimes plus ou quoi? Evora, Evora, après tant d'années. Evora, Evora, une de perdue, c'est ça. Evora, Evora, je te retrouverai, c'est sûr, ça c'est sûr. Evora, Evora.
Stromae, totally amazing, singing about Cesare Evora from Cape Verde, who I had a chance to play with once. She was absolutely amazing. And her whole songs are about, you know, the morna, which is the genre that she plays, is all about that longing for home and longing for love. Then we got Ewa. So Ewa is a really interesting band. They're from Tel Aviv. They are Yemenite Jews. Their father, the grandfather, was singing these folk songs, and these three girls were like, we want to sing these songs. These are pretty amazing. But they, you know, they're urban girls from Tel Aviv. They created this sound, which became quite the hit. They had a really interesting video. And in Israel, you know you're a hit when you're played at weddings, because weddings are a big deal in Israel, as they are most of the world. And when I had them, I first recorded them in Budapest at WOMEX, which is a great music conference. But then when I had them on, they were like on the playlist for every wedding that was going on in Israel, which is like, there is no parallel. I can't even describe it, but you've made it if you're on the wedding list in Israel. So that was Ewa. And it's awesome because they're grown through our help. You know, they're already there, but now they're growing more international. They're able to tour more, and they're just so sweet. And their last name is Haim. So now We're trying to figure out if they can hook up with the Haim sisters and actually do something next year at Coachella. Which leads me to the next point. We've got Gogo Bordello. Eugene is a huge fan of KXP, and he's been at it for a while, but he's one of these artists that I see happen at a festival sometimes where it comes out like a rock star, and it's insane, and the band before him is blown away, and the band after him is terrified to go on stage because he puts on such an amazing show. It's Gogo Bordello, and we love having him. He started this club night on a Canal Street in New York called Bulgarian Bar, and it was like for about a year, it was the most amazing club night. In New York, that's saying something, but it was utterly crazy. Full-on Balkan brass bands, him DJing with a bunch of other DJs, and it was phenomenal. But you could see, like, you know, there's something about him that transcends language, transcends culture, transcends everything. He brings it all together.
Immigrant punk, that kind of was unifying chant for the Bulgarian Mehanata bar crowd. Yeah. And it grew to be a song eventually.
Immigrant, immigrant, immigrant punk. Immigrant, immigrant, immigrant punk. Immigrant, immigrant, immigrant punk. Yeah. Immigrant, immigrant, immigrant punk. Immigrant, immigrant, immigrant punk. Immigrant, immigrant, immigrant punk. Upon arriving to the melting pot, I get penciled in as a goddamn white. Now that I am categorized, officer gets me naturalized.
Immigrant punk, immigrant, immigrant,
as an immigrant punk.
Immigrant, immigrant, immigrant punk.
Now that I'm living up in God knows where, sometimes it gets hard without a friend. Now I am looking around, hopefully I see another immigrant punk. There is a little poker mafia everywhere you go. She's good to me, I'm good to her.
Ah, 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 whoa, whoa, whoa.
Gogo Bordello, if you get a chance to see them live, do. It's sweaty, it's phenomenal, and you'll get to meet a whole bunch of Russian and Ukrainian and Balkan expats that live in your neighborhood. And shots of vodka nonstop. It's so much fun. The Windows Phone team came in and did a little video with me because I use a Windows Phone. I love it. It's great. The thing that I've been trying to push, and I'm glad that a friend of mine, Ed's in the audience, these artists are making music not on Macs. They're making music on PCs because these PCs were the first things that they were given. They were either left there by Peace Corps volunteers, or they're just easier to get, easier to make. And it's one of the things that we've been going back and forth. Like, you have to understand that this music is made. This company's great. But this genre, this particular, the ability to get this music out is powered by Microsoft, because this company's all over the world. And these artists are actually able to access this, put it out, and then get it out. It's you know, they're not the latest, you know, PCs, they're not the latest technology, but they're actually making phenomenal, what I consider, and the most powerful music in the world today using this technology. And it's an interesting story because it's like something that, like, you know, you try to disseminate and it just gets kind of lost because it doesn't fit the marketing messaging that, you know, comes down every year. But it's an ongoing story. As you can see, when they come in, it's like, how did you make this? Where is this thing coming from? And the way, going back to the point that I was making before, music plays well with others. So you're hearing this, like, Kuduro beat or Baile Funky beat coming from Brazil, and then you're having somebody like Katy Perry or Diplo just pick it up, appropriate it, and create something that makes $1 billion. But it started with that one freak, you know, in a refugee camp making an interesting beat with some weird technology on an old PC. And it's just something that, like, you know, I know it gets lost, but it's something that I want to stress. This stuff is being made on your technology. This is a real powerful cultural force. Okay. Some people geek out on food, cars, sneakers, whatever. I just geek out on music. Sharing music is what I do. I'm Darek Mazzone, I'm a DJ, and my Windows phone is my hub. I love this phone. It's a great phone. I have songs, it's my camera, it's my recording device, it is my connector with my social network. As far as DJing in a club or even at the station, I'll use my Surface. It's robust, its touch capability is phenomenal. The great thing about this phone is that whatever I have on it, it syncs to the cloud and then it's ready to go wherever I need it. It shows up on my Surface, it shows up on my Xbox, wherever I am, I can share that experience through any device. When I'm doing my show, I will pick up a track, I'll get some information about that track, about the artist. I know that the information that I need is on OneDrive, it's on OneNote. I share it with my interns, they share it with me. I can access that information anytime. It's a seamless process. I don't have to think about it. It's perfect. Whether it's a song or it's a video or a photo, inspiration comes. Putting them in my phone, the collaboration aspect happens on OneNote, uploading it into OneDrive, and then finishing a particular project on the Surface later on. That's a pretty amazing thing. I could be playing in a different country. The fact that I can just download the set list that I want to play on my Surface that night in a club, I know that it's gonna be there. When I know that it's on my phone and it's on my Surface, I'm ready to roll. Having my information on any device at any time is vital. I'm Darek Mazzone, and this is my Windows Phone. That was fun. And I got a chance to pay the Polyrhythmics, which is a killer local jazz band, who are going to be playing at our Stevie Wonder showcase. When is that? We'll figure it out. So let's go to one other thing. And this is an old story, but it keeps coming up. I play a lot of music from different parts of the world, and I like to juxtapose that music in different kind of settings. So I'll play music from a Palestinian refugee camp, and I'll play some Israeli hip-hop. I'll play pop music from India, and then I'll try to play some pop music from Pakistan. It's tough to find pop music from Pakistan, but I could find it. And these things just wouldn't exist in their countries. You just don't hear that juxtaposition playing well. I've been doing this for a long time, so when during the first Gulf War and the second Gulf War, I was playing music constantly from those regions because I knew it was going to be a shit show. Not that I'm ahead of the time, but it's like war always sucks. And I was getting hate mail. I was people getting pushback, like, what are you doing? Why are you playing music from Iraq? You know, this is our enemy. And I was like, this is bullshit. It's going to be bad. And it's going to be really bad. So, music is fun, it's cool, but it's also a statement because it's important to hear these artists heard. Because I kept stressing this, I keep doing this show, and I've been doing this more often than not, music of people being bombed, and especially when they're about to be bombed. It's like, check this out. Do you like this music? Well, they're gonna be bombed soon. So what do you wanna do about that? How do you wanna address that? And it was hard, and it made it a little difficult. I wasn't getting like death threats or anything, but it was like abrasive. It was like, what are you doing? I don't wanna think about this. Just play little pop songs. But we don't do that at KXP. We're willing to push it if we need to. Yeah, so stressing that, it was like, even DJing live, a lot of this, like in Boston, I started DJing in clubs and I got really bored with the same syncopated beat. So I started playing a lot of this stuff and people are like, what are you doing? They hate this. It's like, no, this is good. Just feel it. There would be like 10 people in the audience, they were loving it, and 30 people just holding back. It's like, I don't know this music. I'm not going to move. This DJ sucks. And it's like, no, we're going to continue to do this. And, I get fired, but then I get hired again. It's important to hear this stuff. It's what makes life worth living. So stressing again, I'm always on a hunt for new sounds. I've been doing this for a while, so I have a collection of people all over the world that will send me things because they know that I'll like one thing or another. You know, I'm not a machine. There are certain things that I like, and I have an audience that likes the same stuff. My spectrum is very broad, but I tend to like things that are super heartfelt, that have got something that moves your hips a little bit, or, you know, comes with like a sense of identity or a sense of purpose that like transcends language, transcends instrumentation. We're like, this is real, this needs to be heard. And I can't stress this enough, and this is, you know, you guys work here, you can do this. Go where there are festivals, go where there is a music scene. We're so freaking lucky in Seattle where every night there's an amazing music scene. Different parts of the world, it just doesn't exist. You know, like you leave your hotel, you're like, there's nothing here. This is really sad. But if you find places that have that, like any of the major cities, India, Nepal's got an amazing scene, go and explore that because you're going to meet people just like you. Like we've all had this. You go to a club and you're all feeling this and it's a great time. You don't know who this person is, but you're having a shared moment. It's an amazing thing when you're having a shared moment with somebody. You don't understand their language. You never met them before. You have a completely different experience. There's this connection that happens and it's amazingly powerful. It changes people's lives. Changed my life, definitely. Okay, so technology and voice. This is an interesting band, actually. So I kept going back to how this music is made. Checkpoint 303 came out of a Palestinian refugee camp in Jordan. And, you know, you think of refugee camps, you don't think of a music scene. But there really is an interesting scene that's coming from that. Because refugee camps are this, I'm going to sound like an ethnomusicologist and I apologize. There's an interesting thing that happens in refugee camps where you've got this synthesis of people in duress, but yet the UN comes in and other countries come in and kind of like advance and amplify them to the 21st century. They get laptops, they get machinery, they get instruments. Like literally people go over like, hey Gibson, we're supporting refugee camp. How about giving us some guitars? And Gibson goes like, yeah, sure. Here's 20 guitars. That's like bands like Tenado Wen came out of. A lot of the electric blues you're getting right now are coming out of refugee camps because they're able to get stuff pretty quickly. It's not much to do, they're not working. So, you know, you're a 17-year-old, you're gonna start playing and you're gonna start, you know, working on some beats. This is what happened with Checkpoint 303. You know, thanks to the internet, I get that music now. I can pick it up and it becomes a really interesting story of who they are, where they were, and especially where they want to be, what their future is. And they're reaching a huge population all over the world, and knowing that they came from a freaking refugee camp is amazing. And if I can play a role in getting that message out is phenomenal. Then I've lived a good life, and I'm happy with that. Okay, so another thing that I wanted to talk about is immigrant songs. So we got a grant from the Vilcek Foundation, which is a foundation that focuses on how immigrants help the United States. It started by, I'm spacing on a person's name, but also an immigrant. And we were asked to like look at musicians. How do immigrant musicians actually interact? What is the immigrant experience for them? How are they being received? So we're a radio station, and now we're like, okay, let's do this thing. Let's do this as a video, because that's our future. So, you know, one of the things that I talk about with Tom a lot is like, we're kind of walking backwards into success. We didn't have this like 5-year plan where this is where we're going to be. It's like, this stuff is happening and we're super excited that it's happening and we're moving quickly on it. But it's the fact that KXP is making a video about immigrants and recording interviews and then them performing live and then disseminating that out. That's also very interesting and new because it changes who we are a little bit in a good way. We become a little more educational and we tell more of the backstory of this. Because you go to, you know, la, 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 thank you, we're done. We're going a little deeper, but we're going into it from a place of trust. Because once again, I keep going back to that. Artists trust us and listeners and now viewers trust us. So we can tell this story and we can get an audience to check it out because we're not lecturing and we know that it's coming from a place where we're good at. There's an amazing band, local band, called Chimarenga Renaissance, and they've dedicated their morning to be here. They're an interesting example of what I've been talking about, how the music is changing. Tende is from Zimbabwe, Hussein from Congo. They both have a strong history in traditional sounds from their countries, but they're synthesizing it through a hip-hop filter using traditional instrumentation, but creating something completely new. And that's the stuff, that's modern global, because it's creating a musical language and it's creating a expression about what's going on in their lives and in the world today. So if we can, Chimurenga Renaissance, please. Dude. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. This is new for us, getting up at 7 and doing a show before lunch. So before we go on, I just wanted to make sure we introduced it our sister over here, Catherine Harris White, a.k.a. Sassy Black. Woo! Thank you. The first song we're going to do is called When It's True Love, Shoot Farther. We kind of stumbled upon this, the music-wise, and just kind of building on what Darek is talking about, because he's been very supportive of what we're doing here, which is a little bit different. This kind of happened kind of like his career he's talking about. A lot of times me and Hussein, we just will start some music and be in the studio, but he likes to like going to his own realm of musical guitar possession. And sometimes he just starts making a beat. So we were in the middle of a song and he's playing a riff and I'm always like, stop, now stop. He's like, no, what, stop. And I just like, press record. And I press record, then we go back to the beat. And then like 2 days later, I come back and I'm like, no, listen to this, this is what you did. And so that's kind of how we made this song up. And the lyrics are really about love. You know, as you get older, you start thinking about love, everything differently. And a lot of things transpired in my life, and I started really thinking about the other side of love. Not the easy stuff like I love you, give you a hug, and all that easy stuff. More of the other thing of like, okay, if I really, really love this individual, or if I'm a loving person, and we have this relationship, what could I do to take the relationship further? You see what I'm saying? So what kind of things can I offer to this music relationship where it's not just making the music, it's like we're gonna take the extra mile, we're gonna get on the phone and we're gonna make phone calls and we're gonna network. It's like, kind of like me and her relationship. So that's what the inspiration behind this was. So yeah, when it's true love, you shoot further.
Promiscuous women, denial for my idol. I knew I was a cocky bastard. I took my calling, I never asked for permission. If I wasn't so loyal, forgiven, I probably found trespass of it. Mocked for my visions and rebellious decisions, cause I refused to submit to self-entitled and be the master's resident. Pair of kings and queens to rebuke submission. If they work hard, they'll achieve any goal they're after. And Hershey stood by him when Bell needed posted, when Lou pulled through and blood turned to water. Learned how to plan for death while my heart was still drumming. All these prayers went around when she needed food and shelter. Despite all my male figures, transgressions, and lack of father, and I laid that sucker to rest and walked tea down the altar. My motives are at peace with your fight to dethrone the king. So I sharpen my spear and I chuck it farther. The curse has been lifted. Your prayers didn't do this. You knelt for me to submit, sucker. Don't even bother. We seek out tropical weather when they swirl the poles. Better repressed our currency crispy, cause it sprinkles down soft to hide. Nothing from my kids. I teach them from the internet. I seen a few BMs with naive babies' fathers. But anyways, I love girls with guns. Let a cock for fun. It sparks everyone. One, we resolute to shoot farther. We trade off shots of bubbly and twig blocks. A family tradition we coin called bubbly pop popper.
When it's true, when it's true, when it's true love. When it's simply just me and you, love. I feel purpose, I feel mighty. There's no other way to describe it. When it's true, when it's true, when it's true love. When it's true, when it's true, when it's true love.
So, Shimmering the Renaissance, and when I first heard them, I was like, where is this coming from? When I found out it was out of Seattle, I was incredibly, incredibly psyched. Then I found a little bit about Tendai and his history and at the UW and his father and his sister, who actually brought Mbira music, was a teacher at the UW. So there's this lineage, and you know, Tendai is, and I don't want to speak for you, but he's taking this thing, but instead of like, you know, just keeping it, like I'm going to play the same music, he's creating his own verse. He's creating his own language with it. He's not discarding it. And we had this conversation. It was just like, no, I don't want this. You know, when you're 17, it's like, no, I'm for the future. It's like, no, I'm going to take this and I'm going to make my own particular instrumentation, my own personal expression of this. And that is the thing that I strive on. That's the thing that I think is really important for Wolpop in the future. There are other channels where you want to hear Ravi Shankar. It's great. It's beautiful. It's my morning mix. But the future, the where artists are taking their song and what that song is about, you know, what the 21st century is really about from a musical expression and from a just the from the poetry and from an international perspective, I think is super important because then we get a chance to hear other voices. And you can't hear other voices on mainstream media. It's just not there. And mainstream media is now literally all over the world. You're hearing the same thing over and over again. You're going to hear the same top 10. If you go to Spotify, look at the global top 10, and it's depressing. Like maybe one or two artists from countries that like push it, like France or Brazil. No, you will hear music in our language from our place. So, you know, I find situations where on my show, huge stars from like Peru, they get more airplay here than they do in their home country. And that's one of the reasons why KXP needs to grow and my show needs to grow, because these artists need to be heard. They're making something really powerful, but there just isn't a voice for it. And it's growing and it's awesome. These guys are playing out, and especially coming out of Seattle, this particular flavor, because you say from Seattle, oh, grunge, oh, okay. Hendrix, it's like, no, there's so much more right now. But this is awesome.
This next one we're gonna do is called The Shackles Are Off. Basically saying, you know, if you've been going through stuff and once you release it, you know, you're free. The shackles are off. I think it's kind of self-explanatory. Mm-hmm. I'm not one for big talking of explaining the songs. I think that's an ethnomusicologist thing. My dad was big on that, so he talked for like 7 minutes and the song was 2 minutes. I didn't understand it, but all right, here we go. The shackles are off. I've been held back all my life, 'cause people wouldn't give me no mic. But now I'm free, I'm free, I'm free. Yeah, come on, who said the future wasn't bright for people addicted to good music and rocket mics? But I've seen the crowd full of Sims, nerds, and thugs that can't get enough of this life. Hustle with drums, so once the boom out and this and beat hit their ears, they done and they convert to the life of palaces. So if the critics that say hip hop's dead, 'cause they can't get payola from their toupee spread. Come on, I've been held back all my life, 'cause people wouldn't give me no mind. But now I'm free.
Songs. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks for taking the time. So, the future. This is really exciting, and this is the stuff that I really want to stress. We were like the first radio station to stream. We won a Webby, which is a funny story. We had a show called Moglo in New York for a while, and first night, I'm in a cab in New York City. I'm hearing myself on a voice, and for a radio DJ, it's huge. I'm in a cab, and the guy's like, "Who's this?" "That's me." It's like, "You are here. What are you talking about?" It's like, "No, this is me." So I go to the Webbies, as a friend of mine was presenting, and I find out that we won a Webby. I had no idea. I was the only one from there. I was a few into my cups by then because I was just on a radio in New York, but it was just amazing. It's just so. It's just typical of who we are. You know, we're like, we don't have a lot of ego, and we're super grateful and humble that all this is happening. So. It's just amazing. It really is. You know, I wish I could go into more detail, but it was like this feeling, like with our YouTube channel and how we started filming bands. It was like this, let's just do this. Let's see what happens. Let's put a camera, you know, in front of these guys and see what happens. You could see in our little studio, you guys were there. It's like Christmas lights and, you know, black gauze. But it's real. It becomes like this thing because there isn't like this gigantic agenda. It's just, let's just do this and see what goes on. We really do well with new technology. I would love Warpop to be the first virtual reality show because, like, you know, to do that and have Chimurenga holograms right in there, it would be just freaking awesome. And it just tells, you know, it's just like, it's an interesting thing. So, like, you know, working with the HoloLens team on something like that would be really cool because we're a bunch of, like, nerds and freaks, just like all the engineers here. We're just like, we like playing with stuff and we like sharing it. And we're super jazzed when people react to it because we know we're doing really well. We're no longer walking backwards into success. You've been to our new home. It's pretty big. It's we're still trying to figure out what to do with it. I mean, there's an interesting... We used to be in small spaces. I mean, we had an office and a broom closet. No joke. Now we've got this long hallway, and we have this thing. I remember this in Microsoft. It's like, you do the walk, and there's somebody coming towards you, and like, what do you do with your arms? What do you do with, you know... Do you say hi or you do an elbow or not? We're going through that kind of process of how do we fit into this much larger space? We have like, you know, we have tons of cameras right now, but we're still trying to figure this whole thing out. And we're doing it from a real authentic place. And especially a show like Wopop where this music is vibrant, it's alive, these stories are vibrant and alive. They need to be heard. And more importantly, they need to be seen because that is where people really get it, all over the world. And thank you for your support. Any questions, please?
So, my question is about when we're talking about technology and music, I want to understand where technology can actually help in two aspects. One is, you were talking about you getting thousands of CDs and someone listening to all of them.
Mm-hmm.
So I assume there's a huge, at least a good amount of false positives or like false negatives.
Yeah.
Saying, yeah, this one's not good, but maybe they were really good. So one, can technology help there? And the second one is, I think we have a lot of smart minds on the acoustics, like how to make your sound actually very clear and mm-hmm. nice. But is there any technological or science going on how can you actually make the music itself better? So...
Yeah, there's a lot of, you know, our studio right now sounds amazing because it's bigger. We, you know, it's constantly evolving. So it's better speakers, better acoustics. I'm super impressed by the new Jambox. It was like, how does this thing make such a big sound? So stuff like that is constantly going on. But there's also an authenticity. Like I had this Robert Millis in just a few weeks ago, who got a Fulbright scholarship, went to India and recorded and interviewed Indian gramophone collectors and Indian record collectors. And the way they listen, the acoustics are, you and I would be like, what the hell is that? But they hear it like that. They hear it differently. So you can over sweeten it and it loses its authenticity. There's a lot with, like, you know, with certain musics where it's not supposed to be that acoustically nice. There's a certain abrasion to it which is intended by the artist to make that work. Not all the time. I mean, sometimes it's like, I played music where it's like, you know, it's powerful, it's important, but it's freakishly unlistenable because there's just something there that doesn't really work with my culture. ways to present that could be really interesting. We're in a space right now. I mean, the latest numbers show that there's 100 million songs available and more on social media right now. We're filters of that. We're going back to the point, you trust us, so you're going to listen to us first instead of working your way through the mire of like, what is this thing? Where is it coming from? Going back to your first point, going from what's good to not good, that's our secret sauce, because an algorithm, you're never going to trust an algorithm. Nobody's going to be driving around with a Pandora bumper sticker or a Spotify bumper sticker on their car, but they've got KXP bumper stickers because they trust us. They trust the station, they trust us DJs. So once you come up like, I've got the solution, you know, I'm going to give you the algorithm which is good, which is specifically for you because you love this music, it might be good for a couple of weeks and then you're like, you're really disappointed. You know, like when you get that Facebook profile, they connect you in this, what, you don't know who I am. You know, it's, we don't disappoint people like that, hopefully. Not yet.
What would you consider your biggest success, and what was your biggest failure, and what did that failure made you do?
Oh, God. My biggest, let's start with the failure. I tried to get Cesario Vota on, and I didn't push it enough. The thing with us right now is that, like, we had Esma Redzepova in. Esma is the voice of the Romani people, and it's a classic situation like Stromae. She's 74, and it's vital to get her recorded because she's 74. You know, she's going strong right now, but next year you never know what could happen. And there isn't, you know, because we have that trust from artists and from listeners and viewers, they'll absorb her music, they'll absorb her presence much more. In Skopje or in Sarajevo, she plays in front of 50,000 people. Like, I remember Matt, who's our mastering guy, is like, who is this? So she's in front of a gigantic soccer audience. Like, how come I never heard of this thing? And that's just, you know, because you don't go out there, but it's there. It's really powerful. So I tried to get Cesaria in, and I didn't push it enough. Something else came up. I wanted to go to something else. And she died, you know, just a few months after that. And I was like, damn it. And like, I just could have had her. It would have been pretty awesome. My greatest success, I don't think I've achieved my greatest success yet. I don't want to say, you know, that I've done it. But getting a Ladysmith like Mabazo, helping build the studio. Because I remember having conversations with Tom and Kevin, everybody's like, we could be really this thing. Because I travel a bunch and I'm hearing people recognize me in Berlin, in Paris. It's like, Darek Mazzone. So it's like, I'm a radio guy. What? How do you know this? And then know my face through the videos. So I knew that we could be something more powerful. I don't know what it is, but we could be something, I don't say powerful, just like we could become a player, and we'd be a good, an honest broker for these artists. Because a lot of these artists just don't get the support right now, or it goes through this filter of the machine where it all sounds exactly the same. And we're fighting the good fight. And the fact that we have the new studio, that's an amazing success.
For the band, I'm just curious where you maintain your inspiration from in getting music from back home, wherever that might be, or in Seattle.
Honestly, we listen to a lot of everything. We're online a lot. Sometimes we have to binge. So, you know, with technology today, you can, like, what were we studying the other day? We'll go into, I was studying European hip-hop. He has a cousin, we went and did a show in London, and he was, like, mentioning all these rappers to us. And we're just like, no, no, never heard of them, no, no. And I'm not really the big European hip-hop guy, you know, because as listeners, we always talk about this. For people who grew up in America and listen to hip-hop, your ear, everyone in the crowd is so advanced on cadences and deliveries and lyrics that when you listen to European hip-hop, you can tell they're still trying to figure it out. So they're saying, like, metaphors and stuff for heavy listeners where it's like, I heard that already. And it's not that they're not good, you know. You're just like, But I've been really getting into their music. And I wouldn't say that's where we are inspiration most likely. I mean, speaking for myself, it comes from our elders. We're very well connected to that. Yeah, we kind of just binge on online and look at what people are going on. And really the inspiration is that because of technology, people over there can actually receive the music. In Zimbabwe, you don't get no music. So when I go home, they'll ask me to come on the radio and never heard a song. They're just like, oh yeah, we just know you're in this group. We saw it said New York Times, but yeah, let's do an interview. So what are you doing now? And it's like, yo, did you know the name of the group? No, but we know that you're famous. It's like, no, I'm not famous. And this is not how it works. So I'm really inspired by just people trying new ideas, you know what I'm saying? Being different, that they're embracing hip hop, and that they're taking the traditions and growing from them, and they're respecting them in the best way that they can. Mm-hmm. But that's my inspiration. I don't know about you, but.
Well, I think we all draw inspiration from each other as well. Like, you know, we're constantly thinking of different things, you know, oh, I got an idea for a new song, and then, oh, I wonder what Tendai's gonna do over that. Or sometimes when he makes a beat, he'll be like, man, I can't wait to hear Hussein over that. Or, you know, Kat puts stuff out and we're like, oh, that's dope. So it fuels each other to kind of, you know, collaborate better, but also, like Tendai was saying, with our elders, you know, having grown up in both musics and kind of learning in both schools and merging the two, it's very inspirational to see people that have gone before us and those music. So yeah, kind of all over. We draw our inspiration from all over.
Awesome. So on that note, even, we've all heard of TV on the Radio or Vampire Weekend and this other's very best. Their sound came from listening to high life guitarists, you know, on the net. So this discourse, this exchange is happening all the time. You know, these are like club kids from Columbia University. They're like, this is good. I want to play this, you know, okay, jazz. And now they're huge. And they still talk about it. You know, they're like TV and a radio, Bravo, Amadou and Miriam, and, you know, blind guitarist and vocalist from Mali. They stole the show. They were just amazing. You know, it's like this, we know how powerful this is. Once people hear it, once they get it, it changes their lives instantly. All right? Thank you so much. Chimurenga, Renaissance.
I feel good. I feel right. I don't be.